Good evening, everyone, and welcome to our September Benedictine Conversations entitled Living the Beatitudes with Dr. Bernie Evans. Here is our guest. My name is Dawn Carrillo, and I am the director of the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. And so on behalf of the sisters and the center, I welcome you all to this space. And I particularly welcome our wonderful guests that we've got with us tonight. I'd like to introduce Bernie at this point. He's a professor emeritus from St. John's University in Collegeville, which is where I got my master's degree. And he also served there as the associate dean in the School of Theology. He taught courses on Christian social ethics, environmental theology, and ministry in rural communities. A couple of his publications include Lazarus at the Table, Catholics and Social Justice, and also Vote Catholic, Beyond the Political Din. So as I said, I got my master's degree at St. John's, and Bernie was my professor there, one of my professors. And I grew up Lutheran and had converted to Catholicism. And so his class, entitled Catholic Social Teaching, was my first deep exposure to the social teaching in the Catholic Church. And I remember in this class just having epiphany after epiphany. And at the end, I have to say, I walked out of that classroom changed with a profoundly deepened understanding of what it really means to be a Christian and what it means to be a Catholic. And I've always been grateful to you for this, Bernie. I always tell people that Bernie is someone who can say really hard truths with such gentleness and kindness that it makes it easier for us to receive these truths, to take them in and really consider them. And I suspect that you will experience this with me tonight. So it is my deep pleasure to welcome you, Bernie, to this space. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity to be with you. I appreciate that, Dawn.
Yes, of course. I had hoped to introduce Bernie with a funny story. And as we prepared before we got online this evening, I said, Bernie, I wanted to tell a funny story and I can't think of anything. And he said, that's because there's no funny stories about me. So I suspect that is not true. I'd like to start us this evening with a little poem meditation by one of my favorite poets at the moment, who is named Steve Garnas Holmes. And so Bernie, have we got you with us?
I hope so. I can see and hear you.
Okay. Let me just check what happened here. Okay. I'm not sure what happened.
Oh, dear.
You can't see me?
I can see you and I can hear you, yes. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, yes.
See me?
Don't see you. Let's go on. I'll go ahead and do the prayer and you kind of see what you can figure out there, Bernie, if you can figure anything out. Yes. So this poem meditation I'm going to begin with by Steve Garnas Holmes is in the context of a scripture passage from Mark, the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus is saying to his disciples, The Son of Man is to be betrayed into human hands, and they will kill him. And 3 days after being killed, he will rise again. And so here's the poem. We don't like dire predictions, especially right now. Yet here is the prophet of hope, telling us the bad news on the way to the good news. This is not about predicting the future. It's about trusting the everlastingness of love and the power of life to endure and the capacity of grace to bring life out of death, no matter what. Because sometimes there will be what? A lot of it. And yet, there is always God's and yet.
Thank you.
Yes. It's good to see you back on the screen. We can see you now.
Okay.
Yeah, that poem, when I read it the other day, it just really resonated with me, Bernie, after our conversation as we prepared for tonight, because there's a lot of dire predictions out there right now. And I know that we're going to be kind of touching a little bit on this, but that line, those lines in the poem, you know, there's always God's, and yet, you know, we just never know the final answer.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That's good.
So, in that frame of mind, Bernie, I would just ask you to start by telling us a little bit about yourself. What would you like the viewers with us tonight to know about you, such as what brought you to the topic of study that you spent your life working with, researching on, teaching, helping others understand it? Just how did you get there?
Well, I would have to credit my mother with a lot of it, at least with the start of it. My father died when I was 7, and she had to raise 8 children. And for much of that time, she worked at the laundry at the Franciscan complex in Little Falls. You're familiar with, I know. So that was a big part of it. She also, from time to time, would make observations about the unfairness in society in a number of different ways. I can't remember at what age I was, but my brother was drafted into the army during the Korean War. And that also felt like something that shouldn't have happened. Absolutely shouldn't have happened, but it did. It was part of life then. Because he had to go there, we had to leave the farm and move into the village of Flensburg. I know you're familiar with that little town. Eventually, much later, then I did go into the Peace Corps. Drawn into that, I was just very, very interested in that. Spent 2 years in Turkey, which was a great experience. Coming out of that, I joined the Bishops' Conference in Washington, D.C., when the Campaign for Human Development started. And I was on the staff when that began. All of this led me to have a lot of questions about what the church has to say about these different issues, about society in general, but particularly about justice and injustice in society and around the world. And that ultimately led me to enter the PhD program at Catholic University and study under my advisor, Father Charles Curran. And after that, well, that was kind of it. The PhD studies, and then continuing to work at the National Office of the Campaign for Human Development, Catholic program funding, social justice, social change programs around the country to benefit low-income people.
Sure. Thanks for that. I know when you and I met to have a conversation about tonight, you had mentioned that, remind me, was it in high school you heard about Catholic social teaching or college or something? It was somewhere you heard about it and you had never heard about it up till then.
College at St. John's University.
College St. John's. Okay. I think this is the case for a lot of Catholics, a lot of people I've come across. And so I'm wondering if you could kind of speak to that a little bit and maybe give us an overview about what Catholic social teaching is and how does that relate to the title of what we're talking about tonight, Living the Beatitudes.
Well, I think that, to put it very briefly, Catholic social teachings are a guide for us on how to live our faith in a changing and challenging world. They address many, many issues that go from one decade to the next. I mean, the first documents came out in 1891 and continued up to the present. But more than addressing specific issues, they provide, I think, a tone for us on how we are to look at our life in society and how we are to be involved and active in trying to build a more just society and a more just world all the way around. That has always appealed to me. I think partly because it just felt like when I was very young, there were a lot of things that were wrong that affected our family, although I probably couldn't articulate them at the time. But it felt real. And going on then through high school with the Croziers and college with the Benedictines, I think I got very well grounded in what could be in terms of what our faith called us to be and to become as individuals and as a society.
And so would you say that Catholic social teaching has risen from the Beatitudes and other Matthew 25, for instance? What would you say about all of that?
Well, I think they have. I mean, you probably can't see a direct link to them, but what Catholic social teachings call us to do and to be and to become are clearly flowing, from my point of view, flowing out of the Beatitudes. In terms of how we are to live, how we are to love one another, how we are to build systems and structures that are just for everybody. I mean, that's not the language of the Beatitudes, I know. But it certainly is there, I think, in the Beatitudes, and provides a backdrop and a foundation for the church's social teachings.
I understand it's not the same language as the Beatitudes, but the Beatitudes and Catholic social teaching are kind of eliciting or hoping to elicit the same sorts of responses from us.
Yes, they are responses along the line of very basically the Christian expectation that we love one another. And that love has to be expressed in what we do for one another, how we build our societies that work for everyone, especially for those who currently are struggling the poor, the low income, the powerless. That comes out of the Beatitudes. I mean, it's articulated well in the Catholic social teachings, but I think the thrust for those teachings is rooted in the Beatitudes. Absolutely.
I remember being in class and getting pushback from some students about certain things that you would say. And so I'm wondering if you could kind of tell us tonight where you've noticed pushback, and maybe you could also articulate. I know there are things in Catholic social teaching that the church sees as rights, not privileges. And I think that that's where some of the pushback can come, in understanding them as a right, like the right to eat, for instance. So, if you could articulate some of those rights and to kind of talk a little bit about where you've noticed pushback, maybe how you've had to handle it, and just some thoughts about pushback.
Sure. Well, the pushback, I think it rarely came in the classes that I was in, although maybe you have a different memory of that.
Might have been outside class, students, you know,
Okay.
without the professor in front of us, yes.
Okay. But no more pushback that the most pushback I experienced to these teachings of the church came in parish settings where I would be given a talk, invited to give a talk in a parish or for a some diocesan program. And then to present these teachings and what I thought they called us to do and to be and become. Oftentimes there would be vocal objections, maybe pushback, but people clearly being uncomfortable with that and with their church telling them that what they ought to do or not do, or do more of or less of in society. And that usually, I thought, usually came from a feeling on the part of some people that the church does not belong in this, what they regarded as the political realm, in that talking about changes that should be made and on behalf of certain people sounded too political for some people. And that elicited sometimes a pretty strong pushback, especially within parish settings. And I think the reason, I could be wrong on this, but I've always felt that the reason for so much of that pushback had to do with people's feelings about their country, that their country can't be that wrong, that we have everything, we're doing better than any other nation. And presumably, in how we respond to the needs of the poor. And I'm absolutely certain that's not true. I know it's not true because I lived in one other country for 2 years where I was amazed, that's living in Turkey, amazed at how they responded to the needs of people in their communities who were less well off. So that was all part of the picture for me. I don't know if I would want to say anything more about it.
So what you're saying is that when people have heard in parish settings, especially the teachings of the church, that sounded different than the way we live our lives in our society in terms of social programs and so forth that are, you know, they didn't accept that from the church is
Right.
what you're saying.
And I think I would add to it that I think partly why that was difficult or is difficult for many people to hear is that most often they don't hear that anything close to that from the pulpit. They really don't. I don't mean that all the preaching is bad. I don't mean to say that at all. But there is this area of our church's life and our church's teaching that just seems to be overlooked and bypassed, both in preaching and I think somewhat in teaching.
So articulate for us, which are the pieces in Catholic social teaching that the church regards as rights?
Well, recognizing, first of all, the dignity that everybody, every human being has dignity, and therefore a right to a life of dignity. And that means just following down the path that if you're going to live a life of dignity, you're going to need to have the basics for living that life, including such things as food, clothing, shelter, whatever you and I take for granted that we need for a dignified life.
Is healthcare a right?
Absolutely, healthcare is a right. That's probably one that I should begin with because we don't recognize it well enough as a right for everybody. They should have it, absolute access to good, adequate healthcare.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, really interesting. So throughout your career, Bernie, you taught for how many years at the at the School of Theology, St. John's?
Oh, dear.
How long?
20 years, maybe.
I thought it was more than that. Okay.
Maybe. Okay.
You'd know better than me. But so during your career, as you worked with the Catholic Campaign for Human Development in Washington, D.C., and then moved into teaching and so forth, how have you seen the church and society shift? What kind of shifts have you noticed during your time?
Well, I think the first, what I would regard as the first major shift that I experienced was the openness to being involved, for the church to be involved in social justice activities, teachings, actions. And I cite again, when the bishops established the Catholic Campaign for Human Development, a national program to primarily to provide financial assistance to poverty programs around the country, poverty communities, and also to carry on a justice education program along with it. That was just a huge movement on the part of the bishops. And I mean, I'm somewhat biased here because I worked with the campaign from the day it started for about 10 and a half years. But I always still regard that as an example, as a model of how the church leadership was able to recognize in the very turbulent 1960s that something drastic needed to be done and to be done by the church.
Okay.
To signal where we are, where we ought to be, and how we are to address the injustices of the time. I thought it was just a wonderful movement on the part of the bishops. Still do.
So do you feel like that momentum has continued?
Not as much, no. But I have to recognize that in the 60s, there was so much going on in the country. 60s and early 70s, riots, cities burning, just an awful lot of things. I remember in the 60s, 70s, working at the Bishops' Conference in Washington with Archbishop Bernardine at the head of it, and Bishop, or later Bishop, Jim Rausch. Both of them were just, I thought, models of guiding the church in this area of social justice engagement and activities. So at that time, it just seemed to me so real, so vibrant. I don't sense the same right now. I think I don't want to be critical of anybody in terms of church leaders, but I don't think there's that passion and that recognition that, yes, even today, there are tremendous and dire needs in society, especially among people who are poor and powerless. And I just don't see us as a church responding to that need as I think we could and should.
Yeah. I was reading some of the Pope's comments recently about our political candidates for president. And one of the things he mentioned was the immigration issue. I wonder if you could speak to that a little bit, just, you know, as much or as little as you would like to, but to give us a sense of what Catholic social teaching, what the Beatitudes call us to when it comes to immigrants.
Well, the Beatitudes call us to work on behalf of the weak and the powerless, to stand for them, to promote policies in our nation, whatever nation that is, that are going to be, that will treat them well and provide a path to a dignified life for them. That's absolutely bare minimum that they call us to do. And, you know, I know sometimes Catholics tend to see the church's teachings in a very much more narrow perspective, dealing especially with abortion, which certainly is a big issue, a big item, but it's not the only one. And we need to be aware of that and to recognize that and to therefore put ourselves in a position to recognize at any given time, in any given year, what other issues are really important for us to consider, especially during an election, because there are always many issues that should be considered, and they're not always the same ones every year.
So I think in your book that I referenced in my introduction, The Vote Catholic, Beyond the Political Din, I think you talked in there about our responsibility and obligation to not be one-issue voters. Is that correct?
That's absolutely correct. Yes. And that comes, by the way, from the bishops themselves, who have always told us that. Now, granted, there is one issue that they do tend to give particular emphasis to, and that's the abortion issue. But at the same time, they also tell us, don't just stay with one issue. Look at all of them and evaluate all of the candidates on the basis of all these issues. And I think sometimes it's very easy to overlook that. And I think we all have a tendency to do a prioritizing of what's the most important issue. And that's not wrong, but it can't stop there. And we need to recognize more than one issue, whatever that issue might be for us, to recognize that there are tremendous needs in society and around the world, and that various candidates have various proposals for how to deal with them. And we need to examine those proposals and those candidates throughout the election campaigns, and never to just stop with one issue, however important that issue may be to us.
Thanks for that, Bernie. And I want to invite anyone out there in the audience to please send in any questions or comments that you have for Bernie. You can send them in by chat. I'm watching the chat screen. So back to this, Bernie, definitely we're in an election year. And so you've spoken a little bit about, you know, not approaching from one issue, looking at them all or as many as we can. And so we're talking about issues, not necessarily that I think should be taken care of, but we're talking about Looking at issues that our faith as Christians tells us to look at, correct?
Correct. Yes, I think we should be. Our faith tells us to look at all issues that impact human beings. Okay, and now granted, the issues of life and death are supreme in that regard, such as abortion, such as capital punishment, and many, many others. But it does call us to look at more than one issue. And I say that even as I recognize that for any one of us, there will always be one or two or maybe three issues that we consider to be most important today and for this election. And there's nothing wrong with that, taking that view. But or as long as we're also open to hearing what else is going on and what else different candidates may be saying.
I know that the Pope has written Laudato Si, on the care of creation, and also the second, the follow-up to it. But I'm wondering what your thoughts are in terms of the Beatitudes, Catholic social teaching, and climate change.
Well, climate change is such a huge issue that affects all humankind and will affect all humankind at for the foreseeable future. It clearly is. And because it affects human beings, and because it can affect certain human beings like the poor and the marginalized, even more so, we should be giving it a lot of attention. It's not some issue out there that's not related to human welfare. It is very much related to human welfare, along with so many other issues that especially impact people with lesser means in a strong and dangerous way. So indeed, God has given us this beautiful creation that we all enjoy and live with, but he or she also gave us the responsibility to care for it.
And it's interesting in Laudato Si that the Pope, he lines up three different ways of thinking about the human relationship to creation. There at first it was the thought was dominion, that we have dominion. And then the second one was stewardship, right? But then he's calling us to kinship now, to understand our place in creation as kinship, that we are a piece of creation, that our brothers and sisters are everything in creation. So this is something that I know is it, the mindset, we haven't all moved that way. That's difficult for some people to kind of switch into that kinship model. I'm just curious if you've had any experience, talking with people about this and what your thoughts are on it.
Yeah, I think that's a difficult one for a lot of people to get their head around. Most of us were taught from little on that creation is there for us to use, to serve us. And hopefully, most of us heard the message that we're not to abuse it. But the strong, strong message that I heard throughout most of my years was that it is there to serve us, that God gave it for us to use. And indeed, if you look at the Genesis creation stories, there's good grounding for that kind of view. But it's not the final word, because we do have to live with creation and live with other living creatures in a way that shows respect for them as also being created by God and being loved by God, and that we are also called to love and respect other living beings and not simply regard them as tools to serve us, which is what I think most people my age, 80 and more or less, were kind of brought up on. That creation is there to serve us.
Right. So I want to go back for a minute to, because a few of the comments that you've been making when we've talked about, you know, thinking about an issue, a voting issue in terms of the best good for all of humanity rather than my personal good. In the same, you know, how do I say this? I think that there's a huge foundation for that in our very individualistic culture, right? When Jesus was speaking these Beatitudes, he was speaking in the context of kind of the opposite. Community was seen to before the individual. In the same way, helping people, there's sometimes judgment attached to that in our society today. Even before understanding the issue, you know, I've heard people close to me say things like, I'm not giving that guy any money. He's just going to go drink it, you know. So I'm wondering, what you think, why we're particularly susceptible to this in our country, this sort of judgment about helping people.
Yeah, I kind of go back and forth on this in different ways, but one of the things that I always seem to come back to is the fact that in this country, I think we tend to think that systems and structures are set in a way to serve everyone equally, and that everyone can benefit equally. And in fact, that really isn't the case. Our educational systems don't always benefit the most needy. Fully. I mean, just the fact that you may have been growing up in Edina probably gives you, and go to the school system, probably gives you a little bit better leg up on getting a good education than if you grew up in some other part of Minnesota that does not have the resources that are found in a community like Edina. That's not to criticize Edina or the people who live there, but it's just a reality that we don't all have the same experience in terms of where we're living, how we're living, and what opportunities are there for us. I know that's a hard thing for a lot of Americans to accept, that the opportunities are not equal. But when you start five steps back, they're not equal.
So I sense that you're also talking about the American dream.
Yes.
Yeah, that it's not, no, it's not just that anyone can do it. Right. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
So Susan sent in a message. She says, I also had a strong grounding in Catholic social teaching from my 16 years of Catholic education. I have been and continue to be frustrated by the misinformation and lack of information that lifelong Catholics adhere to. Do you Bernie, ever become frustrated when Catholics refuse social teaching, and what do you do to deal with it?
Yes, I do become frustrated. Short answer. What do I do? It depends on the situation. If it's a one-on-one, or if I'm speaking to a group and I get that in the feedback within the group, then I clearly address it and try to point out.
In the group, you address it.
In the group, in the group, try to address it, and simply point out that our church is a church that has a very clear gospel-based teachings on loving and treating our neighbor with compassion. Mm-hmm. And there's just no getting around that if you're a Catholic. But what's frustrating to me sometimes is the fact that we rarely hear that from the pulpit. Very often in educational settings, we don't hear much of that, or at least not as much as we could. And I just find that frustrating and an unnecessary fact of our Catholic life.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the reality is we have such wonderful, solid social teachings,
mm-hmm.
but they're so little known.
Yeah. Right. Emma writes in, do you have any suggestions for youth ministers on best practices to teach Catholic social teaching and the Beatitudes to our young people in parishes?
Great question. I think the first thing that comes to mind is to begin with some kind of experience, if that can be done with a class or with a group. Some experiential outing in a community where they may experience what people are going through who live in poverty. I know it's easy for me to say, but it can be difficult to do and to arrange. But I do know from my experience over the years that if people are given the chance, the opportunity to experience the life of people who live quite differently from ourselves, that can have a powerful effect on them. I know we saw that when I worked with the Campaign for Human Development, and when we set up educational programs to involve parishioners in local projects that were being funded by the campaign, by CHD, Campaign for Human Development, that had a powerful effect on how people looked at, thought about people in their neighborhood, or at least in their city or town, who were living in poverty. The experience is powerful.
Yes, very powerful. And then I would probably add in then going back and unpacking their experience, right?
That's essential. That would have to be part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Totally agree.
Yeah, thanks for that. I hope that helps, Emma. And then Susan Zabel says,
Hello, Susan.
Yes, I know you know her. Do you see a connection between the Beatitudes and liberation theology?
Sure. Liberation theology calls us primarily to work on behalf of the poor and the powerless, mm-hmm. and those who are being persecuted. The Beatitudes, if we follow them, if we really live them, will lead us to that same point, mm-hmm. that we have to love our neighbor passionately and concretely. And concretely means taking actions to make life more bearable, more livable for our neighbors who are suffering. So yeah, I think the Beatitudes, I think liberation theology, I know people have different views on that, but I do think it is well grounded in Catholic teaching, and beginning with the Beatitudes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and when I think about love, that's interesting. You say passionately love, Because when I think about the teachings of Jesus, you know, in our society, when we hear that word love, we think this fluffy kind of butterflies in the stomach kind of affection and that sort of thing. But when you're talking about people you don't even know, but you know they're needy. To summon up that kind of feeling is really hard for people. So, what then? Is it the actions that count? What are your thoughts there?
Well, I think that one of the things to do there, I'm thinking in terms of a parish setting, is to begin with something that people can experience, witness, see. And I'm talking about something local, poverty, people suffering, people in need, and move on be from there to connecting them with maybe communities elsewhere, or larger populations that are suffering. But if, I think if we try to help parishioners get a sense of what poverty is like by trying to connect them with the global scene or some part of it, it's probably not going to work terribly well. But a local grounding on in this effort can be, I think, can be the best way to go.
Yeah, I agree. I agree. I want to go back to something that you said earlier. You talked about, I'm not recalling now exactly what it was that we were speaking of, so what the context was, but you made the comment that many people think that that's the church getting involved in politics. Oh, it's about the Beatitude, about receiving Catholic social teachings and pushing back on that thinking the church is being political. So, and a lot of people say that. I've had priests tell me, I've had a priest tell me, my job is not to be involved with speaking out about anything. I'm a sacramental minister. So I'm just kind of wondering what your thoughts are on that. How do you respond to that?
Well, I think my response would focus on the fact that we must not compartmentalize our faith and aspects of our faith. And that by that I mean we must not see our living our faith as being something that happens in church Sunday morning, or religious education, something like that, or maybe even doing some missionary work or some volunteer work for people. That's all part of it, but also part of living our faith is recognizing or trying to understand and respond to this, how our society is organized and for whom it seems to work the best. In are there some places, and are there some other organizations or people that I can join with to try to change some of that? And I by that I'm thinking of programs like well, here in Minnesota, the J Joint Religion, JRLC, Joint Religious Legislative Coalition, and the Minnesota Catholic Conference is helpful in that regard as well. But there are faith-based programs and organizations that are working on addressing injustices, and even more importantly, I think, addressing the systems of our society, structures, laws that either promote or allow injustices to flourish.
Bernie, I have to ask you, what's your favorite beatitude?
Oh my goodness. My favorite beatitude. The one that always comes to mind first is, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." And I think that I think why I partly why I like that is the if we have that kind of demeanor, and by that what that means to me, I should say, first of all, poor in spirit, is the recognition that we are lowly. We're also beautiful creations of God. But poor in spirit also cautions against thinking too highly of ourselves and putting ourselves at the top of the heap, not putting ourselves in a position where we're not able to recognize or appreciate the struggles of people who have less than we do. That's important to me.
I'm reminded of a quote by Pope John the 23rd, where he said, "Here I am at the end of the road and the bottom of the heap." So,
I forgot that one. That's great.
yes, it is a wonderful quote. How about, is there one of the Catholic social teaching directives that most touches your heart?
Well, I always begin and go back to the very first one, the dignity of the human person. Everything flows out of that. If we can recognize that every human being, wherever that person is, whoever that person is, whatever kind of life that person is living, is loved by God, is a child of God, has supreme dignity. I think if we can do that, then I think we will always be open to finding ways to work with such a person, but it has to start there. If we cannot recognize that, the dignity of every human being, then there are a lot of other things we're never going to be able to do with or on behalf of that person. Has to be it.
And that the dignity of every human person is really kind of the backdrop of the Beatitudes. And then, as you said, all our social teachings have risen from that one piece.
I do. Yeah. Keep in mind that the Catholic social teachings are relatively new on the scene, going back to the 1891 when the first encyclical came out, and the Beatitudes. Well, you know where they came from; they go back a little further.
Couple thousand years.
Oh, yes.
So if anyone has any final thoughts or oh, we have one that just came in from Veronica Susan. This has been so affirming. She says, "I do wish more was said from the pulpit, but I haven't seen or heard it either where I live, and I've been on the planet 71 years."
So have I. And yeah, and I think part of the problem here is what's taught or not taught in seminaries. I really do. And I don't mean to criticize all seminaries or be overly critical of them, but I do think the church should take a hard look at that. Because on the one hand, the church offers these wonderful, beautiful, strong teachings on how we are to treat one another, how we are to build society, the systems and the structures. And yet, the people who are headed towards ordination are, I think, not adequately presented with these teachings.
What do you suppose that is? Why do you suppose that is?
Oh, because it has to do with society and not with personal, as it's perceived, not with personal salvation.
Okay.
Argue everything about our lives in society has to do with personal salvation as well, but that's not really how it's taught.
I'm wondering, Bernie, if you could tell us, we live in a very chaotic world. The poem I read, The Dire Predictions, there's a lot of heaviness. A lot of people I talk to through the offerings from the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, I come across people who are asking the question, how do I remain grounded when it feels like things are crumbling around me, falling apart around me? How do we remain people of compassion, people of the gospel? Okay. So do you have any personal practices that you use to sustain and nourish yourself through the uncertainty of our present world? How do you maintain your beautiful grounding in the Beatitudes in Catholic social teaching?
Well, what's important for me is doing a lot of reading, and theological, spiritual reading, scriptures. I don't always succeed in doing as much of it as I want to, or as attentively as I should or would like to. But for me, as an academician, reading is very important. And in this area of my life, reading the scriptures, meditating on that, is important. I wish I were part, I need to be part of more a part of a group that does reading and reflection on that. It's something I need to work on, get more involved in that, because I think that can be so much more helpful, lasting than simply my own reading and meditating, though that too is important to me. I think also reading history helps me. Not always theological, spiritual history, but just history, to be reminded that a lot of what we struggle with today, it's been around before.
It's not new. Yeah.
Not new. People have had to deal with it, and it's worth looking at how they dealt with it as well.
Mm.
So, and then finally, I suppose, in terms of reading, well, I'm drawing a blank on what names I could give you, but good novels, very, very engaging novels that have a real human story to tell. Doesn't have to be theologically oriented, but just grounded in humanity is important, is helpful to me.
Okay, thank you for that. I'm wondering if you have any books within you that are going to be surfacing. Bernie, do you have any plans for a book to write more?
I'm working on one, but it's so gradual, I should hardly mention it. Not sure it'll be done by the time I am finished. Okay. But you know, I still enjoy writing about our moral responsibilities related to the political life. Both in terms of elections and in terms of how we engage in the political world beyond that. And part of that is because I've been fortunate to have worked in different capacities where I was involved in that kind of work, trying to influence from a faith perspective decisions, political decisions that people make. So that's still important to me.
Beautiful. Yes. Well, we are almost at our time. I'm wondering, Bernie, if there's thoughts, words, anything that you'd like to leave us with tonight before we close.
Well, yeah, I think that in these difficult, and I think you mentioned earlier, troubled times, it's easy for all of us to become pretty discouraged and to maybe start thinking that there's not much that I do that can make a difference. Mm-hmm. But I think we should never, never give into that, mm-hmm. and to realize that God has put us on earth for a reason, and we need to keep searching for that reason if it's not clear to us. And mm-hmm. that has to mean keeping engaged in the world and from a faith perspective, from a spiritual dimension, and trying always to bring whatever gifts God has given us to bear on that great project of shaping a better and more beautiful world, one that serves everybody.
Mm-hmm. Amen. That's beautiful. Bernie, I just want to thank you so much for being here tonight. What a timely conversation as we head into the fall and the political arena, especially. Mm-hmm. I've appreciated those comments from you. And I want to thank all of you out there for being a part of this tonight. Thank you for the wonderful comments that came in. Thank you for being here with us on behalf of the Sisters of St. Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment. Bernie, to you and to everyone with us tonight, blessings of peace, hope, and joy to you and your families.
And thank you and the sisters for doing it.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Good night.
Good night.